Hello, this is David Strickland. And this is another in a series of mini lectures on sociology to support the textbook My Sociology. This one is number 4.2 and concerns the topic The Influence of Groups, and it's meant to support chapter 4 within the textbook. If you've been reading that chapter, you've already learned that the basic insight of sociology is that individuals are largely influenced by the groups to which they belong. Now let's think about that for a little bit. How is it that groups influence the individual? And to what degree do they influence the individual? Part of the way that that influence happens is through socialization. Because socialization happens in groups. We've learned in previous chapters what socialization is. It's the way that we learn our culture. And culture includes norms and values. Norms are social rules. So you could say that socialization is the way that we learn the social rules that we're expected to follow in society. But socialization is a process, and it's a process of social interaction. In other words, it's through interacting with others in groups that we learn the norms and values of our culture. Agents of socialization, such as family, school, peers, media, are often groups that we belong to. So how do groups influence us? Well, the textbook suggests four ways. One, groups serve as a source of individual identity. Second, groups influence the self-concept. Third, groups influence how the individual perceives reality. Four, groups influence how the individual thinks and behaves. Let's explore each one of those, one at a time. How is it that groups serve as a source of individual identity? We've already learned that each person holds a number of status positions, and that each status position has one or more roles attached to it. Roles are the expectations connected to a status, and a status is simply a position that a person holds, such as male or female, butcher, baker, candlestick maker, and so on. Now, all the status positions a person has at any one time, we call their social identity or their status set. And it makes sense to call it a social identity because often we think of ourselves in terms of our collections of status. We might say, hello, my name is Dave Strickland. I am married. I have three children. I'm a college professor, I like to go canoeing. All of those things relate to different status positions that I hold. Professor, husband, father, canoe enthusiast, and so on. So our social identity is connected to the status positions that we hold. But the statuses and the roles themselves come from society. And the status positions that we hold aren't just about us, but they're about other people with whom we interact on a day-to-day basis. For example, if I occupy the status of husband, that status connects me to other people, specifically my wife, and to a group, in this case, the family. I'm a father because I have children. I'm a teacher because I have students. You're a student because you're enrolled in the university. Many of the status positions that we hold connect us to groups that we belong to. And since our status set serves as a big part of our social identity, then those groups to which those status positions are connected have a lot to do with who we understand ourselves to be, our social identity. And groups influence the self-concept, how we feel about ourselves, what we think about ourselves, what kind of person we think we are. In a previous chapter, we studied the looking glass self. That's a concept that comes from the work of Charles Horton Cooley. Cooley suggested that we see ourselves as we believe others see us. So our self-image is connected to others. And the others may be an individual, maybe a significant other, But in many cases, the other, in the looking glass self, is a group or even all of society. If I think about what kind of person I am, I often think, what does my family think of me? What do my friends think of me? What do my coworkers think of me? And so on. So the looking glass self shows us that groups influence the self-concept. And groups also influence how the individual perceives reality. Now, when I say perceives reality, I mean the social reality. What is good and bad, right and wrong, what's really going on here in this situation. That's a reality, but it's a reality that we create by social interaction, by agreeing together on what's really going on here, or what kind of person I am, or is so-and-so a good person or a bad person? Is a certain person beautiful or ugly, or more beautiful or less beautiful? Do they sing well or not? Those are things that are created by social interaction. If we agree that it's beautiful, then it becomes beautiful to us. It is beautiful to us. The objective beauty or non-beauty of it is irrelevant. So through social interaction, we define things as being real. And it's called the social construction of reality. We can't all agree that I'm a ketchup bottle and somehow turn me into a ketchup bottle. No. But we could agree on how ketchup is supposed to be used. We could agree that French ketchup is used as a condiment for French fries. And if we all agree that that's what the way it should be used, you're likely to see many of us use ketchup in that fashion. If someone then came along and used mayonnaise as a condiment for French fries, we might think that person is doing it wrong. They're not doing it the way we all agreed is the way it's supposed to be done. So they're violating our sense of social reality. Now, Solomon Ash did interesting experiments that are described in the chapter, in which he found that people are willing to question their own judgment about the physical world in order to conform to the group. What Ash did is he showed participants in a study pairs of cards, and he asked the participants which of the three lines on card two are the same length as the line on card one. There were eight participants in each experimental set. When Ash asked this question, he had already gotten seven of the people to agree to a particular answer. Sometimes the answer was right, physically, mechanically right, visually right. Sometimes the answer was incorrect. But the eighth person, or which was seated somewhere among the seven, the other seven, did not know this. And they heard other people say a wrong answer. For example, if the line was on the card one was the same length as line number two, on card number two, but the other people said one was the correct answer over and over again, what would that person that didn't know they were supposed to give an incorrect answer do? What they did, what many, many of them did, more than one third of them, was they went along with the group. They could see with their own two eyes that the answer was incorrect that others were giving, but they went along with the group anyway, in spite of their own judgment. So people really want to cooperate with the group and define things in the way that the group does, even when it's a group of strangers. Now, the Thomas theorem applies here because the Thomas theorem says, it's from W.I. Thomas, it says if people define situations as real, they are real in their consequences. The reason that's important is because if people in groups create an idea of what is real socially, the social reality, and if individuals who even know that the group is wrong are often willing to compromise and conform to the group's incorrect position, they will follow up on that with behaviors that may have negative consequences. So then, groups influence how the individual thinks and behaves. Another researcher that discussed this topic was Irving Janis, who documented the phenomenon of groupthink. And that's the tendency of groups to develop a sort of tunnel vision and reject alternative points of view in favor of consensus. The idea is that when you have a group together discussing an issue, even if one person knows better than the rest of the group, they often feel compelled to go along with everyone else in the group just so that everyone will be in agreement. In other words, they value the consensus, everyone being in agreement, more than they value the group arriving at an absolutely correct answer. So they don't rock the boat. And when this happens, it's called groupthink. And you can easily see how the groupthink could thwart the efforts of a group, say a committee, say a board members at a business, to make the best choices on the things that they are discussing. So the basic insight of sociology is that individuals are largely influenced by the group to which they belong. How wide is this scope of influence? Think about this. Except for involuntary physical processes like breathing, is there anything that you do that is not influenced by at least one group? Is there anything in your life that's not influenced by groups? If you think about it for a while, it may be difficult to think of anything that you do that's not influenced by at least one group. So what we've discussed on this mini lecture is the fact that basically, as the poet said, no man is an island. Our behavior and identity is shaped by the groups to which we belong. Social groups are influential, a fundamental part of human existence. So these statements sum up why the basic insight of sociology is that people are largely influenced by the groups to which they belong.